Never know. It might be your turn next week. So, Brother Lloyd and John and Ken both done marvelous testimony. Well, I was moved, Brother Ken. Thank you very much. And y'all just thought it was on Sunday night, didn't you? You never know about this crew here. We might do it Sunday morning, Sunday night, but somebody will be ready tonight or next Sunday morning. Just whenever you're ready to give your testimony, come up and do that. You know, the scripture says be ready to give a reason of the hope that's within you. Anytime, in season, and what? Out of season. So be ready to share what God's done for you in your life. You know what? Most of the time when you tell people that you're a Christian, they don't really think a whole lot about that, do they? They don't realize what you are, who you are. As a matter of fact, most part of the world, sometimes they get real sarcastic about it, don't they? They don't, you know, they say they're a Christian over there. But they don't really know, and they really don't comprehend what we are. They don't understand. Today, with the help of the Word of God and the Holy Spirit that's present here this morning, I want to just share with you what we really are and what the hope we have and who we are. You see, if you know who you are and what you're going toward, if the world understood, it'd be a whole different scenario when you tell people you're a Christian. Matter of fact, I know somebody 2,000 years ago come to this earth and they walked this earth. Matter of fact, the princes and the people in authority killed him. The Bible says in Corinthians that if they would have known, if they would have knew who he were, that he was a king of kings, you think they would have killed him? No, they've been worshiping him. When you tell someone you're a Christian today, they don't understand. When you identify who you are, they don't understand. They don't realize that one day the king that you say you serve and who you belong to, if you're a Christian, they don't realize that one day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord. Now, the world don't understand that, but you understand it. They are what we call spiritually discerned. Turn with me in your scriptures, Revelation chapter 19 and 1 Kings, if you would. Chapter 10, I want to read to you a scripture. Now, let's look at this king. Something wonderfully awaits me and you, something marvelous. There's coming a wonderful time for every believer in Christ. Revelation 19, verse 11, if you would. And let's stand up a little bit here. We're going to tarry here till we preach this word this morning. Revelation 19, 11 through 16. Good that you're all here. There's not one of you here this morning that's not here by divine purpose. All of you are here because God has you here for a specific reason. He wants to speak a word to your heart. There's no accident this morning that you're here. Revelation 19, verse 11, and I saw heaven open, and behold, a white horse, and he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns, and he had a name written that no man knew but he himself. And he was clothed with vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen and white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, that with it he shall smite the nations. He shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the wine presses of the fierceness and wrath of Almighty God. And he had on his vesture and on his thigh name written that King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Now, if you just stop and think about that just for a minute, and you can be seated. If you stop and think about what I just read to you, and I'm going to put that in context with what I'm going to say this morning. As you flip back over to 1 Kings chapter 10, if you would, we're going to put that in what was just some ordinary terms this morning. If people could understand who you serve, if the average person that you meet on the street or who you work with or who you come in contact with at the grocery store, wherever you might be, in a store, just traveling around, talking to folks, or going about ball games and whatnot, wherever you go, and have your realm of social contact. And when you tell people who you are, they don't understand what awaits you. They don't understand who he is. They don't understand that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. They don't understand that one day we'll be assembled around him and we'll be listening to his wisdom and we'll be seeing his righteousness and we'll be beholding him. Now, if you're lost this morning, you can't comprehend that. You cannot see it. You cannot understand it. The scripture says that we're void, and Brother Walter actually quoted this scripture this morning, 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9. It says, "For I have not seen nor ear heard the things that God has prepared for those who love him. But we that are saved, we understand it, those of us in the Spirit. We see it." It's an amazing thing sometimes how the Holy Spirit will start to move upon we as Christians, and you begin to realize what awaits you. The world cannot see it. The world cannot hear it. Their heart cannot understand it. But we that are saved can actually begin to see it, praise God. That's why we serve him this morning. He is King. He's Lord. And he's Lord of Lords. Now try to, and if you're lost this morning, I'll try to put this in just average talk today. Okay? And I'll have to do that with the Old Testament. So as you look with me in 1 Kings chapter 10, there was a king named Solomon. The Bible says he was the wisest man that ever lived. But there was one wiser, which is Christ, and that scripture is over in Matthew and Luke. But here we have King Solomon, and there was a queen who wanted to go and see about all his riches. So if you will start the story, if you would, in verse 1, chapter 10. She had some questions. She'd heard about all his riches. She heard about his wisdom, and she wanted to go see for herself what this man had. And she took a 1,200-mile trip to go check him out. You know, like when you hear about someone who's real rich and famous, if you go down to the ball games and you watch a sports star, if you go watch a big boxing match, or you go see a big singer and you just want to go see for yourself what kind of atmosphere is around this person or who he is, or you might take a trip up to Washington, D.C. and look where the president lived. Well, this woman took a 1,200-mile trip to check this man out. So let's look in 1 Kings 10. And when the queen of Sheba, verse 1, chapter 10, 1 Kings, heard the fame of Solomon concerning the name of the Lord, she came to prove him with hard questions. Wanted to go find out, ask him a few things. And she came to Jerusalem with a very great train and camels that bear spices and very much gold and precious stones. And when she was come to Solomon, she communed with him of all that was in her heart. She began to ask questions. Hey, I got a few things I want to know. I'm a ruler too. I want to know about what all the things that you have here. Verse 3, and Solomon told her all her questions, that there was not anything hid from the king which he told her not. And verse 4, and when the queen of Sheba had seen all Solomon's wisdom and the house that he'd built and the meat of the table and the sitting of his servants and the attendance of the ministers and their apparel and his cupbearers and his ascent by which he went up into the house of the Lord, there was no more spirit in her. She had no more questions or no more contentions. Her spirit was emptied when she saw the majesty of King Solomon. Now picture this for a minute. Get this in your mind, what's going on. Howbeit, verse 7, I believed not the words till I came, and mine eyes have seen it. And behold, the half was not told me the wisdom and prosperity exceedeth that fame which I heard. Happy are the men, happy are those servants which stand continually before thee and that hear thy wisdom. Blessed be the Lord thy God, which delighteth in thee to set thee on the throne of Israel. Because the Lord loved Israel forever, therefore made he thee king to do judgment and justice. And she gave the king 120 talents of gold and of spices, very great store, and precious stones there came no more, such abundance of spices as these which the Queen of Sheba gave to King Solomon. Now I just gave you a little outline of what's going to happen in the future. Now, you know, today when most folks come, people run through scriptures and they just read scriptures and they get on to entertaining, and preachers get on to telling jokes, and preachers get on to getting people excited about, you know, a story or something that they tell. But I believe with all my heart we went too far in that as ministers, and I believe we need to back up and punt again. I think what we need to get really down to is what thus saith the Lord says. You know, if you watch all the big TV evangelists, all about entertaining, getting folks excitement and working on emotions and getting people all worked up and in their soul realm. However, America's in a mess today because the pulpits aren't saying anything. And we moved away from thus saith the Lord. It's the word of God that's wonderful and great and majestic. And that's what's going to set us free. The Bible says the truth should set you free. If you don't entertain folks, they're not going to listen very much. If you don't make things exciting, they're not going to be excited. You know, they're not going to want to come to church. However, for the spiritual man and for the saving of our soul, we need the Bible. We need the Bible to come clear and alive to us, and we need to know what thus saith the Lord. Not long ago, this young man, we was going into the ministry, and they were counseling him and asking him questions to see if he was fit and ready for the ministry. And they were all marvel about what all he knew about scriptures and how to do things and knowledge of scriptures and things. And he kept saying, I believe this and I feel this way and that way. And afterward, one of the elders come up to him that were in the questioning of him. And he asked him, said, boy, you come up with some good answers. You're real intelligent. But there's one thing you lack. And you know what? This was brought to my attention not too long ago in my preaching and stuff. It shouldn't be what Danny Perry says, this is what I think or how I feel, this is my opinion. But it should be what the Word of God says. This is what the Lord says. Now, that's what we need to get back to. Here's what God says. Here's what the Bible says instead of what Danny Perry says or what I think or what another minister thinks or what someone thinks. It should be what? What the Word of the Lord says. Amen. So again, I want to bring you to what we're talking about again as far as the Lord Jesus Christ. And here we have King Solomon. The Queen of Sheba travels 1,200 miles. And when she gets there, she sees the majesty of King Solomon's glory. All his wealth. The Bible says that every year that come into his house was 1.25 tons of gold that came to King Solomon's empire. Can you imagine that? I can't. When an ounce of gold is what? $1,300 an ounce. And here we have 1.25 tons of gold that come to King Solomon's empire. Well, what about the Word of God? What about the Lord? What about his mansions? Now, again, I want to bring to your attention, when you tell people you're Christians, and there are sometimes people say, well, here's one of them people that say they're a Christian, and they submit to the authority of Jesus Christ. Boy, that's archaic. Boy, I don't know about all that. That's not politically or popularly correct. Well, let me tell you something. The Lord Jesus, his mansion, the streets are gold. Matter of fact, the doors to the houses are made of pearl, praise God. May not mean a whole lot to you, but it means a lot to me. Look in 1 Kings 10:21. Solomon was so rich, they didn't even use any silver. Everything he had was made of gold. Look at this, verse 21. And all of King Solomon's drinking vessels were of gold. And all the vessels of the house of the forest of Lebanon were of pure gold. Think about that. None were of silver. Didn't he need the silver? It was too cheap. Isn't that amazing? It was nothing accounted of in the days of Solomon. None were of silver. You see that scripture there? You see how rich this man was? Think about his glory. Now, everything I want you to think about today, I want you to think about who you serve this morning. And when you get out there in the masses, when you get out there around people and you tell them you serve the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, mean it. The scripture says in 1 Corinthians 10:26 that the earth is the Lord and what? The fullness thereof. He owns everything. And you know, I'm a joint heir to him. I'm his son. He owns everything. Matter of fact, I think the Bible says that Solomon even had some lions, and he had animals, and he had chips, and he had these apes and stuff, and he had a big zoo. And in his kingdom, he had lions sitting on each side of the palace, 12 lions and stuff, and a marvelous kingdom. The Bible says that all the kingdom there was peace. The first time in the area of Palestine there was peace. Now, if you go over there today and look, it's war over all around Palestine, right? But for the first time in the history of Israel, Israel had rest from all its enemies. It was a type of what the king's going to be like one day. Now, imagine that. Now, imagine identifying yourself with Christ today and folks don't know who you are. The world don't know you. Imagine being timid of saying, I'm a Christian. When one day every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that what? Jesus Christ is Lord. Now, I want you to look with me in 1 Kings 11, if you would. Just flip over there. The wisdom of King Solomon. Magnificent. 1 Kings chapter 11, if you would, verse 1. But King Solomon, now here's the thing. King Solomon was the wisest man that ever lived. The Bible says he was the wisest of all men that ever lived. But I want to share with you something great and marvelous this morning. He was forbidden in chapter 11 of 1 Kings, if you'll look with me. But King Solomon loved, look at the scripture, many strange women, together with the daughter of Pharaoh, women of the Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Zidonites, and Hittites, and all those words, it's hard to say. And all the way down to verse 11, you can read about how he angered the Lord, and he made marriages with these foreign women. And guess what they did? They turned his heart from following God. Although God had blessed him with much wisdom, and he was the wisest man that ever lived, he made a mistake in going after these false gods and following and marrying these strange women, something that Israel was warned about in the days of Nehemiah. And Nehemiah told him, about Solomon. And for God-loving David, God didn't punish Solomon while he was alive, nor split the kingdom. He split the kingdom afterwards. And he did that for David, that he loved so much, sake. And he waited till after Solomon died before he split the kingdom. But what I'm trying to tell you is this, and I want you to listen real close to me, and I'm trying to get you to understand who we are this morning. That God sent his son, and his son was the wisest man that ever lived, the Lord Jesus Christ, because why? He did always the things that he saw his father do. Solomon didn't. He moved away from the counsel of God, and he married these strange women. However, Solomon was blessed. Solomon was great. He was a great king. It was given to him by God. And he was the wisest of men, but he married these strange women. His heart was moved away from God. But let me tell you something this morning. The Lord Jesus Christ is wiser. Romans 11:33 says that his wisdom is too deep for us to even comprehend, the wisdom of the Lord Jesus. I want to tell you this too. In Africa, where the elephants roam and the tigers roam, in the United States years ago when the buffalo roamed, the earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. This is the Lord's. All these things are the Lord's. Everything belongs to him. And that's quite amazing to me that we don't want to identify with him. He is a King of kings and Lord of lords. 1 Kings 10:8. Let's go back over there and see. Now let me explain something to you. I'm trying to compare the greatest king that ever lived to the king that we serve. Now I want you to understand what I'm trying to share with you this morning and who you are in Christ. He's greater than King Solomon. He's wiser than King Solomon. His riches are greater than King Solomon. But look what it says in 1 Kings chapter 10, verse 8 and 9. It said that the subjects of Solomon's kingdom were happy. Now it's hard to get folks happy today, isn't it? It's hard to get everybody on the same page. You know, we got a marvelous church here. Elizabeth Church, a marvelous church. I mean, you can come here and you can sing, you can serve, and you can come here and folks are friendly. And boy, I'm excited about the things going on. And you can come here and hopefully you hear the gospel preached when you do come. That I'm not just mincing words, it's some food for your thought and some food for your soul. And you're getting food in your spirit. And when you leave here, your spiritual man has somehow been nourished. And you leave here and there's something that's happened to you inside. And you don't leave here empty. And you, a lot of times you go to church, and if the Word of God's not preached, Well, then you leave empty and you go away, you go away not satisfied in your spiritual man. But hopefully, you know, when you come here, there's something out there that's given to you, the word of the Lord. And it's not me, it's God's word that fills us. And hopefully you're happy when you're here and you're hearing the word of God. And I've been in meetings where the word of God is being preached, and boy, I just hated to go out there on Monday back in the secular world where it's dog eat dog. And you get in an atmosphere where the word of God is being preached and taught, and you're in the fellowship of other believers, and you get caught up in that spiritual feeding of the Holy Ghost as it comes into a church, and the word of God goes out, and you get full, and you say, oh no, I have to go back out there in the world and face all the jungles of the world. I want to stay in that atmosphere where the word of God's going forth. The men that was gathered around King Solomon, they were happy. Look what it says in 1 Kings chapter 10, verse 8 and 9. It says, happy are the men, happy are those servants, thy servants, which stand continually before thee and hear thy wisdom. Now look real close at that. They were happy men because they were around this rich king, King Solomon. For the first time in the history, Palestine had peace. There was no war around Jerusalem. It was a type of what's coming, the type of the millennial that's coming. Verse 9, blessed be the Lord thy God, which delighteth in thee to set thee on the throne of Israel, because the Lord loved Israel forever. Therefore made he thy king to do judgment and justice. Now I want you to look with me in the scripture, if you would, Psalm 16 and 11. And hopefully I can put this in a context and in a realm where you can understand who you are this morning, so you know who you are, so you'll understand what's coming for you and who you are in Christ. Psalm 16, verse 11, I want you to look in that scripture. Now these men were happy. They were rich. They were full. They were listening to the counsel of Solomon. The scripture clearly tells us here that these men were very happy. They were being filled full of that kingdom's riches and King Solomon's wisdom. But listen what it says in Psalm 16:11, and I want you to see them. Now, if you missed this morning, it's going to be a sad time for you because you'll leave here not knowing who you are. Now look what it says, verse 11. Thou wouldst shew me thy path of life in thy presence. What does it say? Fullness of what? Joy. At thy right hand thou art pleasures for what? Now did y'all see that? Did y'all understand what that scripture is saying? That understands that if you serve the King of Kings, that he will fill you with what? Joy. Now, you know, King Solomon's kingdom, they were happy at his counsel. They were happy to be there. They were being blessed. And that was a great time. And God did that for that nation then. The first time in the history of the Israelite people that there was peace in Palestine. It's not there today. There's no peace in Palestine today. There's war. There's saber rattling and war mongering all around Israel today. They don't have a wise king like they had back then. Solomon, no doubt, was wise. And the men that were around him were happy. But can I say to you this morning, praise God, that when we in the council of the Lord Jesus Christ and we're sitting around feasting at his table and we're sitting around this morning and we can't see the kingdom with our natural eye, we can't hear it with our natural ear, we can't understand it with a natural heart, but the Holy Spirit is speaking to us this morning and we understanding that we serve a king where we're going to be assembled around the throne one day and we're going to be in the council of the King of Kings, which is Jesus Christ. And when you tell someone, a Christian, don't bow your head, don't turn around, don't make apologies, you just tell them, praise God. Thrones at all. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He owns everything on the earth, and I'm a joint heir with him. Everything that he has is mine too. I'm a child of the King. Amen. Don't go around and apologize for that. Don't go around intimidated by that. You belong to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and in his presence there is joy continuously. Praise God. Joy and pleasures for what? Evermore. Praise God. Hallelujah. Isn't that something? Now, if that don't make you get excited, you better check yourself this morning. Get that verse right there and memorize it. Put that in your heart. That's a nugget in the word of the Lord. Turn back with me to 1 Kings. I just tell you what, this scripture is just quite amazing. The word of God is rich and sweet. I know who I serve. He's a king. He gave her all she requested. 1 Kings 10:13. Now look at it. I want you to understand what's happening here. I want you to see this picture. The queen of Sheba come to see King Solomon. And she asked him a few things. She bought him some things. Said, "Well, I'm going to blow him away with the gifts I have to give him. I'm going to show him some of the riches of my kingdom." But when she got there and she asked him some hard questions, she was blown away. And there was no spirit left in her. In verse 13, you'll see what King Solomon did for her. Look at it. Quite amazing scripture. "And King Solomon gave unto the queen of Sheba all her desire. Whatever she asked, beside that which Solomon gave her of all his royal bounty. So she turned and went to her own country, she and her servants." Now think about that for a minute. Have you ever tried to go out there and buy a present for somebody who's got everything? During Christmas time? You look around and say, "What am I going to buy that person? They got everything they need." Well, imagine this. A queen, Sheba, who had access to anything she wanted. There was a king that gave her everything she desired. Now imagine that. Now I want you to think just for a minute. Imagine having a Savior that we have that can give you everything that you can even imagine or think of. "Brother Danny, where are you getting that?" I'm getting that out of Scripture. If you were in our Bible studies a few months ago, you'd understand this. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, verse 21. It says that he's able to give us everything we can think of or even what? Imagine. Now think about that for a minute. Think about how rich our Savior is. Think about our King that's able to give us everything we can even imagine or think. Compared to what King Solomon did for Queen of Sheba, he gave her all her desires, but our King can give us everything we can even imagine or think. Now imagine you going around intimidated, saying that you're a Christian and that you're born again and that you know the Savior, which is Jesus Christ, the King of Kings. Imagine going around to a wicked and adulterous world and being able to ashamed to share your testimony. Thank God that we got men and women in this church to get up in this pulpit and tell the people out here in this church, "Hey, I've been saved. I'm a new creature in Christ. I know the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, who is able to give me everything that I think or desire." You think Jesus Christ is going to be better to us than King Solomon was to Queen of Sheba? You bet he is. There is nothing in this world that will compare to our Lord. Nothing. Now, I want you to think just for a minute. I want you to think just a little bit. Look with me at 1 Corinthians, if you would. And I'm taking a little time, but that's all right. "He is the King of righteousness, peace, mercy, and grace, and eternal salvation. And also, he gives us everything that we think. Not only that, but his kingdom, the Lord's kingdom, is without end." Now, friends, I want you to think about what I just said. Look with me, 1 Corinthians, now chapter 1, verse 30. And here's who you are this morning. Now, sometimes you don't understand these archaic words, and rightly so. I know the King James Version was written by men that spoke a different English or a different type, these and thous and things of that nature. But this is not basically the way God speaks. The words that God was speaking was translated by Englishmen in the 1600s. Let me tell you something. We think we get these new versions today and we want to put it in our modern language. Let me tell y'all something. I get kind of burnt out on people who think they're smarter than God. And they say, "Well, let's change these words up where we can understand it because, you know, let's get us a new NIV or some translation." Well, and nothing wrong with that. I'm not putting that down. But what I'm trying to tell you is this, that the Lord's language is more pure than our language. Our language is really diluted. And I imagine he sits up in heaven and he looks down on us and looks at all our wisdom and says, their wisdom's nothing. And he's speaking a much purer language than we can ever speak. And a lot of people equate the language of the Bible the way God speaks. It's just a translation of what God's saying. And they were speaking in their language of that day. But God's saying in heaven, and I want you to hear here, verse 30. But of him are ye in who? Christ Jesus, who of God is made unto us what? Wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption, that according as it is written, he that glorieth, let him do what? Glory in the Lord. What does that mean? It means that he's righteous. What does that mean? That means that he's made you holy. That means that he's made you pure. That means you have a kingdom that will never perish. Can any of y'all go find King Solomon's temple today? Do any of y'all know where King Solomon's riches are today? Not one of you. It's all gone. It's all perished. There's nothing left of King Solomon's temple that we know of. All the treasures are gone, polluted, gone away. King Solomon is dead. His body is dead. Our Savior's body lives in heaven. He was resurrected. He died. He was buried. His body was taken up into heaven and glorified. Our King is alive today. Jesus Christ is alive today, praise God. Amen. He's not dead. He's alive. I don't serve a dead king. All those subjects that walked around there and saw King Solomon's glory, Queen of Sheba that visited him, all the riches that he had, 1.25 tons every year, all that stuff is gone, cankered. That gold is diminished. That gold is diluted. God's gold is much more pure than the gold of this earth. The streets are made of gold and the doors are made of pearl, praise God. Our Savior lives and his kingdom endureth how long? Forever and ever and ever. Thus saith the Lord. Not what Danny Perry says, it's what the Word of God says. He's made us to what? Joy, peace, righteousness. He has made us him, praise God. Our kingdom endures forever and ever. We serve a king which is much more greater than who? King Solomon. His kingdom died, but our king lives forever, praise God. Now, I don't know if you understand what I'm trying to preach to you this morning, but we are a child of a king and the heir of a kingdom. And our kingdom endures forever and ever and ever. Thus saith the Lord. Now, if you're a Christian this morning, don't be intimidated. Don't be embarrassed. Don't take second place. The world may scoff at you. The world may scorn you. The world may laugh at you. But praise God, praise God, praise God. We serve a king that's alive. And his throne endures forever. Praise God. Stand with me. You may be serving the gods of this world. You may be serving the gold of this world. You may be serving the kingdoms of this world. You may be serving the political systems of this world. You may not want to identify with Christ Jesus today. But let me tell you something. Once you identify with him and you're born again and the Holy Spirit lives in you, you know what happens? The Holy Spirit starts revealing to you his kingdom. The world can't see it. The world can't hear it. Nor their heart can understand it. But once you're saved and you're spiritually you've been made alive, you begin to look through a glass darkly and all of a sudden you begin to see shades of his glory. And one day, praise God, praise God, praise God. Hey, y'all listen. One day, praise God, we're going to see him face to face. Solomon's little guys around him, oh, they were so happy to listen to him. But one day, y'all listen closely. One day we're going to be assembled around him. And we read it this morning. Revelation chapter 19. Y'all remember reading that? Verse 11 through 16. One day we're going to be assembled around him and we're going to see his majesty. He's going to walk in with those robes on. He's going to walk in King of Kings and Lord of Lords. He's going to walk in with those righteous robes, and we're going to see him face to face. We're going to eyeball him, and we're going to listen to his glory. We're going to see his glory. Now, do y'all hear what I'm saying this morning? One day we're going to see our King. One day we're going to be assembled around our King. And we're going to behold Him. What a glorious day that will be. I think there's an old hymn that sings, "What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, when I look upon His face." Y'all remember that hymn? We got that hymn somewhere? Let's sing that hymn. "What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon His face."